Yeah, I'm too tall.
Thank you, everyone. Good morning, and welcome to the second general assembly of the Proforest Alliance. Your Excellencies, guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome. Please take your seats. We do have simultaneous translation being started. French is all about here. Spanish is all about here.
I'm going to squeeze down here.
Welcome again. Good morning. My name is Marco Albani. I'm the director of Tropical Forest Alliance 2020 and a member of the executive committee of the Economic Forum, where the Tropical Forest Alliance is hosted. It's a great pleasure and a great honor to welcome you all here this morning for this celebration of International Forest Day and first day of the General Assembly of the Tropical Forest Alliance. We have a very rich program today. We have some very distinguished guests that have generously given their time to come and join us, and also some of them traveled very far to do that. Before we move on with the program, I just want to thank all the organizers of the knowledge exchanges and the field trips. Many of you have been on field trips and are coming here with that experience in mind, and those would have not been done without the support of our partners. We have a rich program today, and we're going to try to keep on time. We're starting today with a plenary session. We will hear some welcoming remarks from distinguished ministers from Brazil and from the Republic of Congo. We will then have a panel on collaboration in Latin America for deforestation and commodities. We will then move to the knowledge exchanges, and then in afternoon we'll be back in plenary. As you can see, the program is quite tight. There's a lot of moving pieces, so we'll try to keep it on time. I am Italian, so I'm not used to that, but I now work for a Swiss organization, so that has at least they try to push that on me. What's very important is some of the transition will happen after the coffee breaks and after the lunch, and so it would be very important that you actually move quickly. Because as you had seen, this room is quite big. We have a large number of participants, and it will take some time for transition. So please do bear with us and try to be on time. Very good. Without further ado, I want to introduce our first speaker. His Excellency Minister José Sarney Filho, the Minister of Environment of Brazil, who has has generously given his time to give us some welcoming remark. Your Excellency, the floor is yours.
Obrigado. Bom dia a todos. Senhor Vidar Hegersen, ministro do Meio Ambiente da Noruega. Senhor Djombo, ministro da Agricultura do Congo. Seu Marco Alban, diretor da Aliança para Florestas Tropicais 2020, senhoras e senhores, em nome do Ministério do Meio Ambiente e do governo brasileiro, desejo as boas-vindas aos participantes da Assembleia Geral da Aliança para Florestas Tropicais, que este ano escolheu o Brasil como sede, e agradeço o convite para participar da abertura. Felicito a TFA 2020 pela realização deste evento, que considero de grande importância para a identificação de estratégias efetivas de combate ao desmatamento e a promoção de ações que combinem a conservação das florestas com o desenvolvimento da atividade agropecuária sustentável. A promoção do diálogo e da parceria entre governos, empresas, sociedade civil organizada, organismos internacionais e comunidades locais e tradicionais é fundamental. O governo brasileiro mantém-se firmemente empenhado em combater o aquecimento global e trabalhar na elaboração e implementação de políticas para conservação e manejo sustentável dos recursos florestais através do esforço concertado envolvendo todas as partes interessadas. Nossos compromissos internacionais, como todos sabem, são robustos e confirmam as posições coordenadas entre os setores centrais do governo para o uso do solo, agricultura e recuperação florestal. O novo Código Brasileiro, Florestal Brasileiro de 2012, estabelece a obrigatoriedade de todo proprietário de imóvel rural manter cobertura de vegetação nativa de seu imóvel, a chamada reserva legal. No caso do bioma amazônico, a reserva legal obrigatória é de 80% do perímetro da propriedade. O Código também criou o Cadastro Ambiental Rural, um registro público eletrônico de âmbito nacional com a finalidade de reunir e integrar as informações ambientais das propriedades rurais. O sistema de registro por geolocalização, baseada em imagens de satélite de alta precisão, identificando cada um dos imóveis rurais do país, torna o CAR uma poderosa e inovadora ferramenta de planejamento territorial e gestão ambiental, fornecendo informações sobre as florestas privadas. Assim, ele permite atuação qualificada em questões como manutenção da reserva legal, de cobertura vegetal obrigatória, recuperação e reflorestamento de áreas desmatadas e de áreas de proteção permanentes, como margens de rios e áreas de nascentes de cursos d'água, e é ainda essencial para o desenvolvimento do programa Corredores Ecológicos. Já demos por concluída no Ministério do Meio Ambiente a fase de instalação do cadastro. E agora passamos à próxima fase de validação, na qual a participação dos Estados Federados é fundamental. A validação dos dados do CAR permitirá avançarmos nos programas de regularização ambiental, em projetos de recuperação de áreas degradadas e alteradas. No início do mês, lançamos o Sistema Nacional de Controle de Origem de Produtos Florestais, Sinaflor, que deverá ser implantado em todo o país até o fim do ano. O sistema integrará informações de imóveis rurais provenientes do Sistema de Cadastro Ambiental Rural, do CAR, e do ato declaratório ambiental, com informações da cadeia produtiva florestal. A madeira será rastreada desde a autorização de exploração até transporte, armazenamento, industrialização e exportação. A transparência das informações, aliada à otimização das ações de repressão aos ilícitos ambientais, contribuirá significativamente na redução da pressão de exploração ilegal sobre áreas de florestas nativas. Desse modo, o Sinaflor contribuirá para conter o desmatamento nos biomas brasileiros e, ao mesmo tempo, desenvolver a economia. A participação dos Estados e dos demais setores é fundamental no processo. Como um dos maiores produtores de de alimentos do mundo, o Brasil entende a necessidade de desenvolver práticas agrícolas sustentáveis. Estamos implementando a plataforma ABC, um esforço multi-institucional que avaliará o desempenho da agricultura de baixo carbono e do plano ABC e ajudará a monitorar o progresso relacionado ao cumprimento dos compromissos que assumimos no contexto da Convenção sobre Mudança do Clima, do Desafio de Bonn e da Iniciativa 2020. Além dos instrumentos desenvolvidos a partir de nosso sólido arcabouço legal, reconheço aqui a importância que parte do setor privado vem oferecendo. Na Amazônia, já estamos trabalhando com setores como o da soja, o da carne bovina, o madeireiro e o de distribuição de alimentos para estimulá-los a adotar medidas que concorram para o combate ao desmatamento com transparência e participação social. Senhoras e senhores, a fiscalização é e continuará sendo, nos próximos anos, atividade central para reduzirmos as taxas de desmatamento. Devido à instabilidade política e econômica que afligiu o país em 2015 e 2016, os principais órgãos de fiscalização passaram a funcionar precariamente e o desmatamento tornou a subir na região de forma muito preocupante. Encontramos o ICMBio e o IBAMA, órgãos importantes no comando e controle, com orçamentos completamente deficitários. Tão logo assumi a pasta, começamos a tratar esse problema como prioridade absoluta. Assim, a partir de junho, a capacidade de empenho do Ministério cresceu significativamente na lei orçamentária anual de 2016, superando os valores executados em 2015. Negociamos créditos adicionais junto ao Ministério do Planejamento e utilizamos parte de emendas de comissão fato inédito. E formalizamos instrumentos de transferência entre unidades. Apesar do cenário fiscal do Brasil, o Ministério do Meio Ambiente disponibilizou a integralidade do limite para empenho, ou seja, fechamos o ano com 0% de contingenciamento. Conseguimos ainda, adicionalmente, para o IBAMA, recursos do Fundo da Amazônia. Levei no início deste ano, toda a equipe de dirigentes do Ministério em visita a estados da Amazônia para reuniões de trabalho com governadores e seus secretariados, com foco na pauta do desmatamento. Estamos nos esforçando para que as ações estaduais estejam alinhadas com nossa meta nacional. E nossas ações já estão dando resultados. Dados preliminares, portanto, não oficiais ainda, indicam que neste ano já houve uma reversão da curva do desmatamento para uma trajetória descendente. No fim do ano passado, anunciei a quarta fase do plano de ação para a prevenção e controle do desmatamento na Amazônia. Essa fase foi elaborada com base nas categorias fundiárias mais afetadas pelo desmatamento, tendo-se constatado uma distribuição mais significativa dos desmatamentos em áreas privadas, seguida de desmatamento em assentamentos e em glebas públicas federais sem destinação. O eixo de monitoramento e controle do BPCDAM será intensificado nessa nova fase, junto com os eixos de regularização fundiária e ordenamento territorial, fomento às atividades produtivas sustentáveis e de instrumentos normativos e econômicos. A inclusão deste último eixo busca o sucesso duradouro no combate ao desmatamento, que só alcançaremos com a valorização da floresta em pé. Eu tenho sempre dito que comando e controle é muito importante. Não fosse ele, nós não teríamos tido essa diminuição que tivemos ao longo desses últimos 10 anos no desmatamento da Amazônia. Mas ele não vai ser a solução definitiva para a Amazônia. Essa vertente comando e controle tem sua importância, mas a vertente mais importante é a vertente da sustentabilidade. É preciso que se valorize a floresta em pé. É preciso que se dê alternativas econômicas que façam com que a pobreza seja combatida e as pessoas sejam incluídas. E para isso, a gente tem que valorizar o meio ambiental. Dessa forma, nós temos também agido nessa segunda vertente, promovendo o manejo sustentável. As concessões, elas aumentaram já agora na minha gestão, as concessões florestais, em mais de 18%. E com o Sinaflor, que eu já falei com vocês o que, que ele é, que acompanha todo produto de origem florestal, com o Sinaflor funcionando, com o CAR funcionando, os dois conversando entre si, a gente vai diminuir bastante a ilegalidade e vai poder ter mais tranquilidade em darmos foco a essas concessões florestais para a exploração sustentável da Amazônia, de tal forma que a gente consiga gerar emprego de qualidade, gerar renda e, ao mesmo tempo, manter a Amazônia prestando seus serviços ambientais. Estamos expandindo nossos esforços para adotar medidas de mitigação e adaptação em todos os biomas, a prestação de pagamentos adequados, baseado em resultados e rede mais, será fundamental para a continuação de boas práticas e a ampliação das metas. O Brasil desenvolveu um sistema de manejo para a produção da madeira florestal amazônica que concilia, como falei, o uso e a conservação dos recursos florestais. A dimensão da cobertura florestal brasileira, as metas ambiciosas sob o Acordo de Paris, o compromisso político do governo do presidente Temer com o desenvolvimento sustentável e as leis, políticas e planos de vigor para prevenir e combater o desmatamento e para promover a produção agrícola sustentável nos gabaritam para iniciar e consolidar parcerias nacionais e internacionais. O Ministério do Meio Ambiente tem interesse em acompanhar os trabalhos e as iniciativas da TFA 2020, que são, em suas grandes linhas, coincidentes com as prioridades do Ministério e as diretrizes para combater o desmatamento e a degradação de florestas em execução no país. Portanto, desejo a todos bom trabalho, que desse trabalho a gente possa fazer uso em defesa da sustentabilidade. Muito obrigado.
Thank you so much, Your Excellency. And the leadership, thank you so much for your leadership and the leadership of Brazil so far has achieved the largest reduction of any other country in the world. So what you've already done is fantastic, and what you're going to do is also fantastic. And now I would like to welcome His Excellency Minister Djombo, the State Minister for Agriculture of Congo, who's also a partner of TFA at the Africa Pongo Initiative. And I would welcome your remark, Your Excellency. The floor is yours.
Monsieur le ministre de l'Environnement du Brésil, Son Excellence Sarney, Filho, Monsieur le ministre de l'Environnement de la Norvège, Monsieur Marco Albini, directeur général de TFA 2020, Excellences, Mesdames et Messieurs les ambassadeurs, je voudrais d'abord, à l'occasion de cette journée qui est la Journée internationale de la forêt, vous féliciter et vous souhaiter une bonne fête à vous qui êtes les amis et les autorités de la forêt du monde. Mesdames et messieurs, je vous remercie, je remercie les organisateurs de m'avoir invité à cette assemblée générale. Je ne crois pas qu'ils étaient très sûrs que j'allais venir, mais je suis là. Et parce qu'on se connaît, on a échangé, et je peux vous dire d'emblée que le Congo n'avait pas voulu signer la déclaration de Marrakech. Pourquoi? Parce que il est habitué à signer des déclarations sans avenir. Déclarations, des intentions, sans engagement. Bon, on est fatigué avec ça. Nous sommes des hommes d'action et des hommes engagés. Il faut donc travailler dans un cadre défini pour pouvoir évaluer ce que nous faisons ensemble. Donc, c'est simplement cette réserve qui nous avait amené à ne pas signer la déclaration de Marrakech, à laquelle nous adhérons, parce que le contenu de cette déclaration rejoint parfaitement notre politique agricole, notre politique environnementale, notre politique forestière du Congo Brazzaville. Mais aujourd'hui, j'ai pensé, après les échanges que nous avons eus, venir honorer cette assemblée pour signer ici un mémorandum d'entente avec TFA 2020 pour que nous puissions travailler la main dans la main. Mesdames et messieurs, nous vous apportons ici notre engagement et nous savons donner. Nous savons donner, le Congo a donné déjà à l'humanité beaucoup de choses. Je voudrais prendre l'exemple du clonage de l'eucalyptus que nous avons mis au point pour la première fois au monde en 1975 à Pointe-Noire. Et en 1978, nous avons reçu des stagiaires brésiliens en provenance de Aracruz qui ont appris la technique qui a permis à la société Aracruz du Brésil, bien sûr, de révolutionner ses plantations et à l'ensemble du Brésil de révolutionner les techniques de plantation. Au monde entier, dans l'Argentine, l'Afrique du Sud, le Portugal, aujourd'hui la Chine, ils travaillent sur les techniques de clonage de l'eucalyptus. Des plantes en général, plutôt des arbres en vraie grandeur tirés du Congo. Nous avons donc donné au monde cette inspiration pour révolutionner les plantations forestières. Nous en sommes fiers. Beaucoup de gens ne le savent pas, mais il faut le dire. Si nous ne le disons pas, qui va le dire à notre place? Nous avons également donné à la Malaisie se lance de palmier à olive. Puisque nous sommes sur le palmier, aujourd'hui, la Malaisie est le premier producteur et exportateur d'huile de palme. Nous en sommes fiers, mais le Congo est un tout petit producteur. Mais nous ne sommes pas jaloux, au contraire, nous sommes fiers d'avoir partagé. Également, de notre petite station domaniale de la Djumuna, nous avons pu exporter des éleveurs vers Cuba. Nous sommes heureux de voir que la pisciculture, l'aquaculture à Cuba s'est bien développée, aussi avec l'aide du Congo. Nous avons été à l'origine de la promotion de l'initiative Bassin forestier du Congo. Aujourd'hui, c'est un processus ficelé qui a près de 80 partenaires mondiaux parmi les plus grandes puissances du monde. Nous avons également assuré la promotion d'un processus comme REN+. Je crois que les autorités de REN+, qui sont dans la salle, me connaissent un peu. Parce que j'ai passé presque toute ma vie professionnelle à défendre la forêt tropicale, la forêt tout court, avec près de 24 ans d'expérience ministérielle dans ce domaine. Donc, nous ne faisons pas la théorie des choses, mais la pratique. Et nous souhaitons que la pratique soit généralisée. Elle ne peut l'être que dans le cadre d'une coopération internationale sincère, que dans le cadre d'une coopération technique et scientifique normale, et bien sûr avec des volontés politiques bien affirmées de réussir ensemble les programmes que l'on met en œuvre. Nous avons, permettez-moi également de dire que nous nous sommes lancés dans la promotion de la gestion durable des forêts en mettant au cœur de notre action forestière l'aménagement forestier qui aboutit à la certification forestière. Et nous avons opté pour le standard le plus rigoureux de certification au monde. Le FSC. Nous sommes en train de vouloir mettre en place aussi un standard national pour que nous ayons la possibilité d'une double certification. C'est à ce titre que le Congo détient 32,5% des forêts certifiées FSC au monde. Je dis bien 32,5%. Je crois que c'est un record et nous voudrions continuer à aménager toutes nos forêts, les 23 millions d'hectares de forêts naturelles, pour qu'elles soient certifiées. Nous avons promu également une initiative. Je vois le conseiller de Monsieur le ministre de l'Environnement, conseiller aux relations extérieures, qui a participé avec nous à toutes les discussions pour promouvoir la coopération entre les pays des trois bassins forestiers tropicaux du monde. Pour qu'il y ait échange d'expériences, d'informations, et que la forêt commence par son action interne à se développer. Si nous prenons des initiatives comme REN+, les forestiers s'en plaignent et estiment que c'est une initiative financière et non forestière. C'est pourquoi elle est difficile à mettre en place. Certains pensaient même que c'était une ligne d'horizon qu'on n'atteignait jamais. Mais mon pays, par exemple, est accédé maintenant à la phase d'investissement et en train de mettre en place des conditions pour que cette phase soit exécutoire. Nous avons donc voulu que les pays forestiers tropicaux, notamment des trois bassins de l'Amazonie où nous sommes, du Congo et de l'Asie du Sud-Est, puissent coopérer entre eux parce qu'ils ont les mêmes problèmes. Mais il y en a qui ont eu déjà des solutions à ces problèmes. D'autres pas encore. Ce n'est que dans le cas des échanges que nous pouvons réussir à nous donner la main pour trouver des solutions pour la planète. Tout le monde est enthousiaste à l'idée de cette coopération. Tout le monde est d'accord que le gouvernement des pays concernés signe un accord de coopération. Tout le monde est d'accord en avance. Et nous devions signer l'accord où? À Rio plus 20. Donc il y a 5 ans. Nous n'avons pas pu signer l'accord parce que le Brésil et l'Indonésie n'étaient pas encore prêts. J'espère qu'en 5 ans, on a avancé et qu'on va faire bouger les lignes. Mais c'est un accord important pour nous tous. Nous avons besoin d'échanges, effectivement. D'avoir des échanges de délégations. Nous avons des mémorandums d'entente. On a même un projet de mémorandum d'entente entre le Brésil et le Congo. C'est ce type de coopération qu'il faut promouvoir. Que ceux qui ont des bonnes pratiques forestières les partagent avec les autres. C'est ça l'objectif. Nous avons porté le Congo, je veux dire, a porté la voix de l'Afrique à Rio plus 20 et a participé fortement aux négociations à cette conférence. Mais nous sommes sur le palmier. Permettez que je lance quelques idées. Il y a 11 mois à peine, je viens de quitter le secteur de forêt. Et maintenant, je m'occupe de l'agriculture. Dès que je suis dans l'agriculture, j'ai bien mes collaborateurs. Attention, palmer, oui, pas dans les forêts. Attendez, monsieur le ministre, vous n'êtes pas ministre des forêts, vous êtes ministre de l'agriculture. Je leur ai dit, attention, cacao, pas dans la forêt. En savant, ils se regardent, mais comment on va faire? On n'est pas préparé, il n'y a pas d'exemple dans ce domaine, mais vous nous apportez des révolutions impossibles. Ben, j'ai dit si, c'est possible. Nous voudrions donc, dans le cadre de TFA 2020, coopérer avec tous ceux qui ont des expériences en matière de développement des plantations de palmiers à huile hors forêt. Hors forêt. Des plantations industrielles. Et il faut y associer la recherche agronomique, mais aussi des sources de financement qui permettent de développer ces initiatives. Sans cela, il est impossible d'avancer. Sur le cacao, c'est la même chose. On n'est pas sur le cacao, mais c'est la même problématique. Le cacaoyer est une plante d'ombre. Alors, si on fait l'agroforesterie, c'est-à-dire en savane, on plante d'abord des arbres à croissance rapide qui commencent à créer de l'ombre 1-2 ans après, on plante le cacaoyer. Il trouvera des conditions croissance comme dans une forêt naturelle. Pourquoi s'attaquer à la forêt naturelle alors que nous pouvons gagner deux fois avec le cacao et les autres arbres que nous allons planter pour séquestrer le carbone, mais aussi pour tirer d'autres bénéfices économiques et écologiques. Cela est possible, mais comme je l'ai dit, il faut qu'il y ait une coopération active entre les uns et les autres. Il ne faut pas travailler en vase clos. Je suis certain que l'initiative ici engagée nous y conduit. C'est pourquoi, en tant qu'homme engagé, j'engage le Congo et nous allons travailler avec vous tous pour que la promotion des plantations du palmier à huile hors forêt puisse être une réalisation concrète et non un simple rêve. Mon fils s'est lancé, comme par hasard, il y a déjà 3 ans, dans des plantations du palmier à huile en savane. Et je crois qu'il a déjà 400 hectares qu'il est en train de développer sans moyens suffisants pour aller plus vite. Mais je sais qu'avec l'initiative actuelle, des gens comme lui, des jeunes diplômés qui ont refusé de travailler dans l'administration et la politique et qui préfèrent faire l'agriculture va être soutenu. Mesdames et messieurs, je vous remercie.
Your Excellency, thank you so much for your remarks. It's remarkable to see what a man of your experience in this field has been able to achieve. We are now moving to a very interesting discussion on partnering for solutions for sustainable commodities in Latin America. And I want to welcome our moderator, Isabella Vitali, who is the country director of Proforest for Brazil. Isabella, can you?
Good morning, everyone. We've just heard incredible experience in some policies, public policies, from Brazil and Congo, and also on the importance of collaboration, technical collaboration, and also in terms of sharing these experiences between the developing countries that have forests and are struggling to decouple deforestation from production. What we're going to do now is have some examples of collaboration from and a perspective from different aspects of society. So we have a great panel that I'm going to invite in a minute to provide their perspectives on how they see collaboration being part of accelerating this agenda forward. So I would like to invite Mauricio Lopes, he's president of the Brazilian Research Institute in Embrapa. Please also welcome Marcelo Vieira, president of the Brazilian Rural Society. Leonardo Fleck is program officer for the Gordon and Betty Moore Foundation. Marcelo Furtado is executive director for Instituto Arapyau and also facilitator for the Brazilian Coalition on Climate, Forest and Agriculture. And finally, I would like to invite Juliana Santiago from the Amazon Fund, BNTS. And Mark Murphy, Vice President for Corporate Responsibility at Cargill. So as I said before, this panel is really to give us different perspectives in terms of what's the contribution from different sectors in this broad collaboration to decouple deforestation from production. It is a massive challenge. We know that not a single player in this reality can handle this by itself. So what we're going to hear now, starting with Mauricio from Embrapa, is their collaboration, how far we've got so far from their perspective. Mauricio, with this.
Okay. You hear me? Okay. Bom dia a todos. Eu gostaria de iniciar cumprimentando a Isabella Vitali, aos membros, aos participantes do painel, aos ministros, autoridades, a todos os presentes. E, muito rapidamente, compartilhar com os senhores e com as senhoras o que tem sido a contribuição e a parceria da ciência agropecuária no Brasil para que o nosso país e a nossa produção agropecuária, agricultura e alimentação no Brasil possam caminhar mais rapidamente na direção da sustentabilidade. O Brasil, até os anos 70, ainda era um importador de alimentos. A partir dos anos 70, o nosso país fez a opção por desenvolver um modelo de agricultura baseado em ciência e, a partir daí, e num espaço extremamente curto de tempo, de 4 décadas, o Brasil conseguiu alcançar sua segurança alimentar e, mais que isso, se projetar como um grande provedor de alimentos para o mundo. Eu destaco 3 grandes avanços nessa parceria que a ciência agropecuária foi capaz de prover para o nosso país. A ciência agropecuária no Brasil nos ajudou a transformar os nossos solos pobres e ácidos em solos férteis, nos ajudou a tropicalizar cultivos, grande parte das espécies de plantas e animais que são utilizados para alimentação e agricultura no Brasil vieram de outras partes do globo, muitas delas de países de clima temperado. Nós aprendemos a tropicalizar sistemas de produção, isso teve um impacto enorme na produção agropecuária e na sustentabilidade no Brasil. E o terceiro grande ganho da ciência agropecuária no Brasil foi o desenvolvimento de uma plataforma de práticas sustentáveis que é inigualável. Poucos países, ou talvez nenhum país do mundo, tenha a plataforma de práticas sustentáveis para a produção agropecuária que o Brasil tem. Eu estou falando aqui do plantio direto, estou falando do nitrogênio que na soja, por exemplo, é absorvido do ar por bactérias fixadoras. Estou falando da grande revolução que está em curso no Brasil agora, da intensificação sustentável com sistemas integrados lavoura-pecuária-floresta. Esses ganhos em conhecimento, em ciência, permitiram que o Brasil faça toda a sua produção de cultivos e florestas plantadas em 8% do seu território, cerca de 68 milhões de hectares, e 19,7% do seu território para pastagens. Então, o Brasil utiliza um espaço relativamente pequeno do seu imenso território para toda a sua produção agropecuária. Isso permitiu que o Brasil conseguisse chegar ao presente conservando 61% da sua vegetação nativa. Com um detalhe muito importante, 11% dessa vegetação nativa está nas propriedades rurais por um efeito mandatório da lei chamada Código Florestal Brasileiro. Então, o Brasil tem uma conformação inusitada, um país mega diverso, um país com uma base de recursos naturais extraordinária, um grande produtor de alimentos, um país mega diverso que tem conseguido, através do conhecimento, da ciência e do uso inteligente da sua base de recursos naturais, reconciliar essa condição de grande produtor agrícola e também de um país mega diverso com uma base de recursos naturais extraordinária. A ciência tem sido parceira do Brasil na construção de políticas públicas importantes. O nosso ministro falou do Código Florestal, que é um arcabouço legal que nos permite utilizar as propriedades, as áreas de produção agrícola de forma planejada e inteligente. O Código Florestal Brasileiro foi construído em parceria com a ciência, com o melhor conhecimento científico disponível, e já completa 5 anos esse ano. Uma outra grande parceria da ciência na busca de uma produção mais sustentável no Brasil é o desenvolvimento do plano ABC, Agricultura de Baixo Carbono. O Brasil tem hoje um arcabouço legal que orienta, talvez, a política pública mais bem estruturada, mais robusta em todo o mundo para a busca de uma produção sustentável de baixo impacto e de baixo carbono. Tudo isso construído com base em conhecimento gerado pela ciência agropecuária brasileira. O plano ABC é uma política pública que estimula a incorporação de tecnologias como o plantio direto, a fixação biológica do nitrogênio, o manejo de resíduos animais, os sistemas integrados, lavoura, pecuária, floresta, que já alcançam no Brasil cerca de 11,5 milhões de hectares, nos encaminhando para uma lógica de produção carbono neutro, de baixo carbono. A minha instituição, a Embrapa, acaba de liberar no final do ano passado os protocolos para a produção de carne carbono neutro a partir dos sistemas integrados lavoura, pecuária, floresta. Em suma, o que eu quero compartilhar com vocês nessa fala inicial é que a ciência no Brasil tem sido parceira das várias instituições de governo na busca de um caminho para que o Brasil avance mais rapidamente na direção da sustentabilidade. No suporte e no apoio à produção sustentável de alimentos, no suporte e apoio do protagonismo do nosso Brasil como provedor de alimentos para o mundo, no suporte e no apoio à gestão inteligente e planejada da nossa rica base de recursos naturais, no suporte e no apoio à construção de políticas públicas que nos faça desenvolver as atividades econômicas dentro dos melhores preceitos da sustentabilidade e do desenvolvimento sustentável. E nós estamos, com base em ciência, construindo o que eu entendo será a próxima grande revolução na produção agropecuária do cinturão tropical do globo, essa revolução da intensificação sustentável, da possibilidade de se fazer uma agricultura 365 dias por ano, né, usando de forma intensiva as áreas que já estão abertas e, com isso, reduzindo a pressão sobre a nossa rica base florestal, sobre as nossas áreas com vegetação nativa, que nós definitivamente queremos preservar. Esse é um patrimônio fantástico para o Brasil e eu acho que nós estamos construindo um arcabouço de colaboração, de contribuição, de políticas públicas que vão, certo, já destacam o Brasil em todo o mundo e eu tenho certeza absoluta que seguirão colocando o Brasil em grande evidência como um grande protagonista na construção de uma produção inteligente e sustentável no futuro. Obrigado.
For a Brazilian farmer, it's a great honor to be sitting next to Embrapa, who created our tropical agriculture in the recent decades, which was non-existent, and more recently created new technologies for intensification of this agriculture, leading to a tremendous growth expansion in the same occupied area without the need of developing new areas. And we still have a huge potential for expansion in marginal areas in degraded pastures, and also by developing new models of integration of different cultures. In this sense, the development of marketing chains that guarantee the supply of forestation-free commodities is very important because it brings a fair valuation to Brazilian production in the world market, which will bring returns to the good farmers, to the good producers. We feel now that we must develop new models also to promote new models of agriculture, let's say a climate smart agriculture, which will not only be focused on a few commodities. These marketing chains have been very successful, let's say in soybeans, wheat, and a few others, but we must show the market that an integrated model of production with rotation of cultures, with integrated grain and meat and forest production, the models of a low-carbon agriculture, analyzing the whole property, having as the major focus the full conformity with the forest code, which is the most embracing environmental legislation in the world. No other country has the concept of legal reserve in every single property that we do have. This must be shown as a good model for the whole market, for the expansion of agriculture in tropical areas in other countries. And also, we also have the most embracing labor legislation in agriculture. We have workers at, in agriculture in Brazil having the same rights as urban workers, which is quite different from many other important agricultural producers, sometimes based on illegal immigrants and other irregularities. We must create new models to show the world that we do have a model that is being developed and making good progress every year for a climate smart agriculture. And also our main work is to show all producers in Brazil the best model so that they can move towards these more sustainable models, which we have a number of demonstrations that the most sustainable models also bring better returns to producers. So this is, it's good from the environmental point of view, from the business point of view to farmers, for the good of the whole country, and also for the good of all consumers all over the world. As a very part of the growth of food production will come from Brazil in the next decades with the use of these marginal and degraded areas which are slowly being converted to low-carbon agriculture. That's the model that we must incentivize to Brazilian producers and show to the world market.
Okay, well, first of all, I'd like to thank the organizing committee, Isabella, for the opportunity to be here representing the Moore Foundation and our partners in the collaboration for forest and agriculture. And I'd like just to highlight that I gained 3 degrees there that I don't have, so I probably didn't study enough to get all those 3 degrees there, just to make sure. I'd love to have all those 3 degrees. But anyway, I think my reflections this night, based on all the conversations that we had yesterday, actually some meetings started yesterday, and we had this bilateral discussions on different teams. And, I talked to many of you that participated in field trips, and I heard several inspirational stories about what you saw and also the challenges that we have had to implement these quite ambitious commitments, corporate commitments to reduce deforestation in supply chains. And I just realized that we have actually an outstanding opportunity here to make a meaningful difference for the people and for the planet in the next years. And we have actually a quite specific window of time to catalyze that change. And it's probably the next 5 years where we need to find a way to get to a tipping point where implementation of these commitments will gradually accelerate, right? And I feel confident that in meetings like this, we feel that we are gradually converging towards specific definitions about how this is going to happen, alignment around the organizations warming about what is happening here. But the pressures are going to be quite outstanding, right? If we look at the pressures today, they're small compared to the magnitude of the pressures that we would expect to see in the next couple of decades with the growth in demand, and we know the role of South America in meeting that demand. So I think the key challenge for us in terms of collaboration is how can we tap into the collective talents and expertise and networks and assets that you all have, right? Which is extraordinary. You and others that are not represented here, how can we make those assets that we have more shareable so we can tap into that, capitalize that change, because no single organization will be able to do that. We need actually significant efforts to integrate all these efforts so the specific pieces we add up to something bigger than the parts. And I think that's the mantra of the TFA, right? And it's also the mantra of the CFA. The CFA, so please don't confuse the two organizations, the groups. So I'll talk a little bit about the CFA, the Collaboration for Forest and Agriculture. The Moore Foundation, a couple years ago, decided to launch 3 new initiatives focused on helping decouple food production from ecosystem degradation at the global scale. We observed that there was momentum being built around the Super Goods Forum and several commitments made by companies. And we initiated with some experimental grant-making in this area to try to understand the opportunities for us as a philanthropic organization to contribute to that realized that while there was a lot of innovation in this field by Lab and NFU and other organizations, most of these initiatives, if not all of them, were struggling to scale. You know, there were significant barriers to scale and a lack of capacity sometimes to scale those initiatives. So we realized there was a lot of fragmentation in the field. The different organizations, they were not connected as they could be connected. The different initiatives were not sharing lessons as they could share lessons. And we were losing an opportunity. So we thought from a philanthropic perspective that we could help with that by changing the way we approach our grant making. And then we created three initiatives, one focused on agriculture, one focused on seafood markets, and one focused on the finance markets. And we created this partnership model in each one of them. And in agriculture, we call it CFA, the Collaboration for Forest and Agriculture, where we chose a few key partners, in our case, WWF, TNC, and NWF, organizations with a long track record of working in the priority commodities and geographies that we chose to focus on, which is beef and beef and soy supply chains in Brazil, Argentina, and Paraguay. And organizations that can operate in multiple scales, like bringing, you know, what's happening at the global scale to what's happening at the regional scale. And we work with these organizations to co-create our strategic frameworks, to basically define how this work would be designed and implemented over the next 5 years. And we provided 2/3 of our funds for this collaboration. About a third we still have to complement the work that the CFA is not doing with additional activities in different areas. And the collaboration also agreed to re-grant at least 50% of those resources to the broader community, because obviously they didn't have the capacity to do all the work that is needed. Again, nobody has, no single organization has the capacity. So we are now working, we launched this collaboration last year, we are now working to bring a broader network of organizations, mostly organizations that operate in the regions, but a few organizations that work also at a global scale. And we formed a governance structure to lead that work, to re-engage with the stakeholders. So the idea is to provide resources to catalyze this, or to stimulate this level of coordination, integration of the different activities and initiatives, not just within the collaboration structure, not just among organizations that receive funding, but also with the other initiatives that are that exist and that are aligned with those similar goals in the region. And just to highlight, this is not the collaboration to supplant other institutional arrangements. The goal here is that CFA will focus in strengthening and amplifying the institutional arrangements that already exist, such as potentially the TFA and several other institutional arrangements that exist internationally and in the region.
Thank you very much.
Obrigada, Isabella. Obrigada por entrar pelo convite. Eu represento o BNDES, sou a chefe do departamento de Junto Fundo Amazônia. Related to the national strategy to prevent and combat deforestation. And one thing that's very unique I would say, in the Amazon Fund, based on your question, Isabella, is that all the priorities and focus that the Amazon Fund should have in analyzing and supporting projects is based on a participative governance that is the essence of its management. So we have a steering committee that meets at least twice a year that discuss the main reasons and, of the deforestation and identify what should be the actions that should be prioritized by the fund to be supported. So currently we have approximately 90 projects supported, and those projects go from the support of sustainable production activities. So we support traditional communities, indigenous peoples, peoples that live in the Amazon and live from the forest, settlements, and so how to use the forest in a sustainable way and also generate income from their livelihoods. Another axis that we support is also related to the strategies, monitoring and control. So we have various actions that includes the implementation and improvement of monitoring systems of deforestation, intelligence information that is provided for the states and municipalities. Yeah, so this is also an important axis that we've been supporting so far. And also we have some projects that relate to the land use planning. So we have an important support in the implementation of the national strategy of indigenous territories land and also the land title regularization. So those are the are very linked to the national strategy, and so far we have succeeded in having significant results. The rural registry system is also one of the priorities. We have a significant we have approximately 14 projects supported within the states, and with a large amount with a large area of enrollment that tends to be input to our next focus that might be the restoration of significant areas. And this committee that the steering committee that meets, it's formed by representatives from federal government, from the states of the Amazon region. Usually the secretaries of the states represent their states. Usually the environmental secretaries and the civil society representatives. And this forum, it's a possibility to discuss and to give input to the national strategy as well. So it's a way that we sit together and we discuss the main issues and how the Amazon Fund can be even more effective. And from that, after the steering committee was created, even the states have established a more constant discussion as they established the state secretariat's forum, and based on that, they discuss lessons learned from each state and what should be the common strategy to combat deforestation. And the Amazon Fund also is able to, based on the projects we support, we are able to put together discussions and workshops to also discuss the lessons learned. So in this axis of sustainable production activities, last year we organized a workshop that put together more than 100 people and beneficiaries of the projects that we support, to discuss, to share the results achieved so far, to discuss social technologies and how and the lessons learned as well, and how to be even have more impact and scale up the results. And this year we will also organize a workshop to discuss the rural registry system process and what should be what are the, also the lessons learned and what should be the next focus to the implementation of the forest code. So this is the way that I think the Amazon Fund has actually contributes to sharing this knowledge and common lessons learned.
Working well because it was hard to yeah, it's working. So thank you very much for the invitation to be here. Thank you TFA for the invitation. Before talking about the coalition itself, which I actually think is less important in a way, I think it's more important for us to talk about why we need to work together to solve challenges. And when I see the date 2020 here, I wonder how many of us realize that we only have 33 months for 2020. And if you think about the fact that we have 33 months to achieve that and the challenges we have ahead, if we only sit together to build conversations and to create enabling environments without real action, we're failing ourselves. And I think therefore that one of the key drivers for the Brazilian Coalition on Climate, Forest and Agriculture to come together was basically the sense of failure that we all came out from the Forest Code debate. We came out of a debate where we felt we were even further divided, that we felt that we did not give, although we did give the best of each parts, we did not achieve the best of the sum. And then we said, okay, should we try something different here, having that learning curve? Could we try to come together and have a real conversation of what is possible to do together, but that will answer this time frame. And the first thing we realized is that we needed to create a space of trust, because you would have to explain exactly what are your capabilities and what are your limitations. The second issue is that we recognized a very important role that governance has that, and therefore public policy, and the importance of public policy as a framework for this. The third element we discussed was the very important social authorization, the social enabling factor, because ultimately it is society that decides if a company is sustainable or not, if a policy is sustainable or not. And therefore, having engagement with civil society and having engagement with society at large was a paramount for this conversation. Otherwise, it could be just a small club of leaders on a sector trying to move the sector forward. But I think that what made a big difference in the coalition was the fact that because we have this multi-pronged approach and we had representatives from academia, from civil society, and from industry, we were able to have difficult conversations, convergence in many points, and these agreements that we still have them, but at least we have them with a lot of light on it, and every time trying to go back and assess if it's possible to deal with it. I think if I look back in the Brazilian history and think about why we were able to move ahead on deforestation, as it was mentioned here before, I think it's because we were able, as a society, to make deforestation rate equal inflation rate, in the sense that every Brazilian knows when inflation rate starts going up, that's not good news, and every Brazilian knows when deforestation rate goes up, that's not good news. But we all know that the deforestation indicator is one of many indicators that will explain if this is sustainable or not. And sustainability goes way beyond deforestation. Deforestation is just one indicator, a very important one, a very easy one, but only one. And if we don't put the other elements of the financial mechanism, of the corporate action, of civil society preparedness, to monitor and do social control, will fail it. And I think we are coming to the realization that if Brazil wants to be the leader it is aiming for in food production, and forest products globally, we will need to have the governance, we will need to have the social control, we will need to have the financing mechanisms that are related and required to play that role. And we know that we can't do that together in a globalized society. This is something that you do with others. And I think that's a very clear indication for us on how to do it. And then comes the point, let's do it. When you say let's do it, it's incredible how the pace of engagement changes, because many actors are not prepared to do things together. Many actors are not prepared to leave their zone of comfort. It's uncomfortable to sit with someone that thinks very different than yourself. It's uncomfortable when you sit on a table and you know you have way more power than the other one, but you know that if you don't listen to the other one and if you don't incorporate some of the learning lessons from the other one, your actions will fail. Because at the end of the day, that social license is required. And I think if I look back in the recent actions from this year, be it on the environmental registry, be it on the SINA floor, I know the coalition was one of the elements that were involved in making it happen. And the reason we got involved in making it happen is because we think those are pillars, structural pillars of a low carbon economy that is inclusive and just, which is what we want at the end of the day. So I think the coalition is an experiment. We're not ready to tell you this is a happy group of people that came together and can do it. I think we have a lot of challenges, a lot of failures, but we also have some early victories that indicate to us that moving on the idea of facing the real challenges, talking to the people we normally don't talk to, and trying to get things done in a short time frame is moving us ahead. Thank you.
Murphy and I'm from Cargill, based in Minnesota. It certainly is an honor to be here to be the one non-Brazilian on the panel. It certainly makes me stand out some, but I'm going to say I'm joined, fortunately, by three of my colleagues here, Larry Nabotelli, Renato Nogueira, and Yuri Ferris. And Cargill has been an active member of TFA and participated in 5 of the 7 field trips this week, where we had other Cargill colleagues involved in some of those other field trips as well. So quite a set of engagement in TFA, so it's a real honor to be here. I want to talk some about the value of partnership, because it's been a journey that we've been on for a long time on this issue. I put it in the context of a story a bit, and talk about 3 phases and what I think we are. I've been involved in this work since, for the last 13 or 14 years. I've been coming to Brazil, working with Brazilian colleagues on the deforestation issue. I go back to 2004, 2003, really, in Cargill, where corporate headquarters and our European office discovered that our business was building a state-of-the-art facility in a place called Santarém. Because the business, which was riding the tide of impressive agricultural growth in Brazil, saw the economic value of putting a major export facility on the Amazon River so you could bring soybeans down the Tapajós from the middle of Brazil and ship them in just a few days to Europe. And we said, this is a problem, because the Amazon is the Amazon, and the northern members of our team were really quite concerned, and the business in Brazil said, no, this is our day, this is an opportunity for Brazil, this is the right thing to do, we'll do it. And we operated from a reputation standpoint, protect our brand. We were known at the time, Cargill, we're a 150-year-old private company. We are the large sleeping giant of the food sector. So, fast forward to 2004, and we thought, well, we should begin to work with an environmental group to help us think about this. And we reached out to an organization that we're good friends with in North America called Nature Conservancy. And I learned they had a gentleman named David Cleary working in Brazil, and in fact, working in the Amazon. And I called David Brazil. I called David in Brazil, and I remember to this day, I remember where I was standing, and David said, we met for the first time on the phone, and David said, I don't care how nice or how good Cargill is, you are becoming the poster child for deforestation in the Amazon. And I went, wow, that's interesting, and I went back to my senior leadership. And I don't know if you're familiar with the story of Apollo 13. It was made famous by a movie, and there's a point where the spaceship is going lost in space, its equipment has failed, and they say, Houston, we have a problem. Well, that was our Houston, we have a problem moment. Fast forward a few months later, and we started hearing rumors that the problems were going to get deeper, and our least favorite organization at the moment, Greenpeace, was beginning to think about putting a report out. And Greenpeace used a very smart strategic tactic, since we were a privately held company, and they said, we should target Cargill's customers. And I remember to this moment, the day that I was standing at a baggage carousel to collect my baggage on vacation, when a call came from headquarters and said, there are people dressed in chickens running around McDonald's restaurants in France. And the CEO of McDonald's has called the CEO of Cargill and said, fix it. And that iconic moment changed Cargill forever. We've been working on forest issues ever since. Today we embrace Greenpeace, we argue with Greenpeace. It has fundamentally changed the way we engage with the civil society sector of the company. It fundamentally changes the way we engage with stakeholders. So I'd say we've been in three phases. There's the reaction phase, there's the proaction phase, and there's the execution phase. The reaction phase is that phase in 2005, 6, 7, 8, where the GTS was forming. And at the time when the GTS was forming, we had no idea that it would be so important as it is even today to keep people at the table, to bring people together, to bring the government in. That's the reaction phase. The urgency. The execution phase came along, proaction phase, where let's fast forward to 2010, 11, 12, even get us to this time of the New York Declaration. Bold commitments, ambition, more people coming in, where we felt very alone that day when Greenpeace attacked Cargill. I sit here today and say, well, we're not alone anymore, certainly. The proaction phase, where a lot of people began to come into this, and a lot of people began to make commitments. And we all, many of us, signed on to the New York Declaration as a symbolic moment in time where governments, private sector, indigenous people, civil society came together to make this bold leap of faith. My CEO and others that I work with, we all turned after that and went, oh my God, how are we gonna do this? And so again, now a phase where I say we're in the execution phase, where collaboration, collective action is really needed. I was in the Sahara up north in Matopiba this week, and the issues with WWF and EPOM and others, and clearly the issues in the Cerrado are still very, very contentious. We're very proud of the Amazon. We've celebrated the Amazon moratorium with Greenpeace. And we were here 6 months ago, celebrated in Brazil, celebrated in the US with McDonald's and Greenpeace. There's lots of things to celebrate. We can celebrate the success of agriculture here. But there are still some areas that are very contentious. And the Cerrado is certainly going to be a challenge to reach 2020. That's why we're encouraged by some of the things we heard about yesterday. The GTS has come together and they're beginning to talk about the Cerrado. We have the Brazil coalition, so it's not dependent on northern NGOs and northern companies just impose something on Brazil, but in fact, the Brazilian sectors are working together and figuring out how to work it. 10, 12 years ago, we were afraid to get in the same room with Bunge, ADM, even Wilmar in the palm sector, where we are also very active. Today, we're in the same meetings. We're operating very competitively. And so what we're encouraged by as we go into this phase, this execution phase, is we do need action, and we do need to work collectively. We need things like what we heard about the accountability framework yesterday, which is a way to harmonize these systems so we're not all fatigued with redundancy, we're encouraged by what the CFA is doing, trying to find the right tools, find the right definitions, because we all share the same values. We are all more transparent than ever before. And we can, you know, get to that point where we can find a way to sort of verify and move from the command and control that was talked about by the minister to a, to an era where we can hold ourselves accountable. Thank you.
About the contributions that all these different actors that have different roles in stopping deforestation, decoupling it from production, how they have been evolving and working with others in the other regions. We've heard about the contribution of science to that, to the sustainability of agriculture. So we've also heard about how important it is for producers to embrace that agenda and produce more sustainably using all that science that is coming up in this innovative research. We've also heard about how donors themselves are starting to look for collaboration and looking for different ways of reaching impact through collective effort. The Amazon Fund with Juliana as well, it only exists already because of collaboration between two different governments, Norway and Brazil, and the way it operates, it incorporates a participatory governance in its essence. We've also heard about the Brazil Coalition, which is in itself a collaboration between very different actors in Brazilian society. And finally, a very interesting story from Mark about how the private sector, a specific company, changed their attitude towards working with others completely over the last years. And you probably all heard here about this African proverb, if you want to go fast, you go alone. If you want to go far, you go together. The problem is 2020 is around the corner and we want to go fast and far. So my question to you all is, how would you like to see this fantastic membership that we have here? All of these, we have, just looking at the audience earlier, I could see people from at least 10 different countries that I know, that I recognize. And from all the different sectors that have some contribution towards this agenda. So, although we have all been doing bilateral or collaboration in smaller groups, there is a fantastic opportunity here of getting the whole international community that is willing to make change together. So my question is, how would you like to use this platform to accelerate our common goals? And how would you like to encourage others to use it? Would you like to go first?
Yes. Yes, very quickly. Isabella, we are talking about partnership and collaboration, and to have real partnerships and collaboration, we must enhance comprehension of what we are trying to deal with. Certainly, we are talking about the very complex and challenging goal, which is how we move faster towards the sustainability of our production chains. And to build convergence and agreements, we must enhance comprehension of what we are dealing with. And for this, we also have to invest more in communication. I think the coalition could help a lot enhancing communication to society on how we are evolving on this movement towards sustainability. I think there is a shortage of understanding out there about the advances that we already have made. I like, and this is especially important in this post-truth era. I like the phrase by Winston Churchill that before the truth can put on its shoes, distorted information already crossed the world. I think we have a huge challenge here in communicating well to society how far we have already moved towards the goal that we are discussing here. I think there is a very short understanding out there on the advances we have already made. Along these lines, I think there is also a shortage on strategic thinking and formulation. If we are talking about convergence, if we are talking about agreements, we must be able to put together a platform for strategic thinking and strategic formulation that has the degree of transversality that will allow us to understand the nature of the issues we are discussing, which are complex. I think there is a shortage of think tanks. I think there is a shortage of anticipation. We must build capacity to draw scenarios and to anticipate possible futures. What kind of challenges we will be facing on production chains we will be facing in 5, 10, 15, 20 years ahead? We don't discuss it much because we do not have, I think, the number and the diversity of think tanks, of strategic thinking and strategic platforms to help us gain a better understanding of what is really rich sustainability in production chains in complex environments. We are talking about environments in the tropical belt of the world that will be pressured by all sorts of challenges, global change, the pressure on increasing production of food and agricultural products. I do not think that we have the strategic thinking and the strategic formulation platforms to deal with the challenge of gaining a good, transversal, and deep understanding of the challenges that we will be facing in 5, 10, or 15 years, to use this as a good communication tool and to use this as a good platform of knowledge to mobilize all the forces that we have to mobilize to face the challenges that we have ahead of us.
Well, I would say if you want to achieve real results on a larger landscape scale, the model that we have been able to develop here, that we were very lucky to be able to put it successfully, because the model of coalition of climate, forests, and agriculture, gathering more than 130 entities interested in reaching real results, this is a great progress, because we are not there discussing the ideal models of beautiful projects. We are discussing what's feasible, can be implemented with real results, how to make real progress towards implementing the forest code, towards implementing the Brazilian NDCs. And we have very effective task forces discussing specific issues like CRA, like FRA, like ABC, agriculture, like work on infrastructure. And this is, of course, slowly, because it's a huge challenge, but making continuous progress all the time. And I think this will be the best model for making progress on any kind of NDCs worldwide. And we are, as Marcelo said, having some problems, but I think that we are making very good progress, quite successful in designing the right strategies, not yet reaching important results, but we will get them. So.
Well, I would like to contribute to the 3 points around how TFA can play a role, right, in helping this process. I think collective action is pretty nasty, right? I think we all experience that. It's confusing, sometimes it's chaotic, and that's the nature of collective action. We have to get used to it. And as part of it, there's the need of norming, right? And information sharing, and there's a need to capture lessons, share now. So I think norming is something that I would say is critical in this sector, and something that TFA is already doing, you know, helping to more norming in this field. because there's so much stuff happening, right? It's hard for anyone of us to actually understand everything that is happening, and I definitely learned a lot from this demo today. The other point is the connection between global processes and regional processes. There are very few organizations that can play that role, and I feel that sometimes people in the regions lose sight of global trends and what's happening internationally with companies and, you know, in the financial sector. And this might mean that we might lose some of the opportunities. At the same time, global processes with organizations who are operating at a global scale might miss the point of, in terms of what are the challenges in the regions and the processes that already exist there that we can tap into. The third point would be around we need to do a better job, I think, and we collectively need to do a better job understanding all these different initiatives and these different coalitions, because they are quite focused on specific areas, right? They have overlaps, but they have sometimes agendas that go beyond the agendas of others. And even the TFA, right? The coalition doesn't have exactly the same goals of the TFA, but they have a significant overlap. So how can we better understand the differences and the values added in each one of these coalitions, so we don't get stuck, the more foundation, for instance, and our collaborators, we don't get stuck with our own agenda, right? And we can have the visibility of how this connects with the other broader agendas. And I think TFA can also help with that.
And I tend to agree with you. I think we have a couple of initiatives going on, and I think TFA might have the role to connect those initiatives and provide knowledge sharing, but put together plans to not only stimulate the sustainable agriculture and low carbon agriculture that is expected to increase anyway. But we have the big challenge of not deforest new native vegetation. And we do have significant areas that are already deforested or degraded that might be considered a possibility of being recovered and used in a sustainable and productive way. I think we have the challenge in Brazil particularly. We have announced a very ambitious NDC that includes 12 million hectares of restoration and reforestation. So this also needs to engage the private sector in planning in a short-term process of implementing or regularizing their environmental liabilities and making part of this effort of restoring degraded areas in their own properties. So I think the TFA has also this this opportunity of putting together efforts and funds to support this ambitious strategy of restoring significant area. I think for the Amazon Fund particularly, this is one of our challenges. Our area of actuation is the whole legal Amazon that corresponds to 60% of the Brazil territory. So I think we will have an important role in that, but we are a small part, I think, of the big challenge we have in the next years.
Thank you. In terms of working groups, and I like to remark that in the coalition we have working groups, and normally when you say working groups, people hear more the group part than the work part. So we like to stress the work part of the working group. And the good news is I think we have very active working groups in the coalition. One of them just gave a workshop yesterday here on sustainable tropical forest management. That group, for example, worked very heavily together with the Minister of Environment in Brazil, helping get the Sinaflor, as the Minister remarked, launched. And that was very important because you need to get the feedback from civil society of what is acceptable, to also feedback from industry from what is needed. And And I think we succeeded on getting those two elements together there. We also have the Low Carbon Agriculture Working Group that is indicating to the government and to the society that the issue is not really money, it's technical assistance. It doesn't matter if you pour more and more money unless you get the technical assistance together with it. And I think these are very important things because we normally say the money is the problem. We have a group working on carbon valuation. I think this is a very, very important area because we have such a wide range of views on carbon. And we have the do nots, but we maybe have a lot of do things that we can agree, but we're not having a proper dialogue on that. And finally, the restoration and reforestation, which the paramount concern we have is that unless you put a landscape approach, unless you put research and development for native species, you're going to do a lousy job. And we have huge opportunity to take this, recover degraded land in the country, put less stress on existing forests, make money, help people, and improve research and the use of a wide range of incredible species that we have in the Brazilian biome. So we're looking at those things as also breaking innovation and creating this real economy. We're talking about how you make this living for the country and not something nice that you go back to an international conference and you say you're doing it. Now, to do that, we also identified very important issues that I think this group can work. One is called de-risking. Nobody wants to invest, really, in forests. Everybody likes to talk about it, but go find the money. So de-risking and having de-risking facilities for state-level initiatives and national-level facilities, as well as for low-carbon agriculture, I think can be a very important element. No credit for illegality. One of the big problems we're facing in Brazil is that if you want to play legal, you play with less advantage than the illegal player. So we have to stop credit for illegality and give the due support to the operators that are operating within the forest code, within the law, within the labor standards, and that is not happening. We also think that carbon pricing is a very important discussion that we need to have. But those are a few examples of what we call enabling measures. And there are many others that we can explore. And finally, there is a conversation about the role of government and the role of command and control. And I think it's very clear for us in the coalition that the government and command and control and proper policies that indicate the right track are extremely important because those public policies are policies for all and not for a few. And we come to the realization of that. The last element I want to put, and then I have to go back, Mark, to your story, because unfortunately I was very involved in that story, so I also have a piece of it to share with you. Back in 2006, I was the campaign director for Greenpeace in Brazil, working with Paulo Dario in the Amazon, in our Amazon office. And I'll tell you this story because I want to bring this issue of dialogue and transparency. Because we knew the report we had at hand and the impact it would have, we contacted Cargill headquarters in Brazil and they did not want to meet with Greenpeace. I'm no longer at Greenpeace, I'm just telling the history of when I was there, okay? And if you want to talk to Greenpeace, you can talk to Paulo, who's here in the back of the room. The headquarters did not want to talk. So we were very concerned. And I said, let's go to the US. This is too big, right? So we asked for a meeting with Cargill in the US. And there was a convention in Washington. Three directors of Cargill were there. And they said, we'll give you an hour. So a German colleague from Greenpeace Germany, an American lawyer from Greenpeace USA, and myself went there for the meeting. The meeting lasted 3 hours, not one. And we offered to Cargill that we write the 10th chapter. There were 9 chapters in the report. The 10th chapter was, Ed Cargill, hearing all this, agreed to do this, this, and this. Okay, maybe you would not agree with all the 10 points. Normally NGOs ask for more, and they already know you're gonna get less and all that. But what is interesting on this story is that Cargill said, okay, let's think about it. 2 weeks later, we need more time, okay. Another 2 weeks later, go ahead. the reason I'm putting this out is what I think changed a lot in Cargill, in the corporate sector, and in the dialogue between in the private sector and civil society, is that the dialogue has better quality, the dialogue is more transparent, and the dialogue is more effective. You have a lot of reasons not to agree on many things. How can you identify key areas where you can find consensus that is meaningful, it will have impact that you want, and you can work together? So where I think there was a big advance, and probably that's why the coalition was so crazy to allow me to be the facilitator of the coalition, when I did most of the actions on all these guys that are the 150 members of the coalition. It's because we improved our capacity of being effective, having quality conversation. So one thing I love about Valeria in the coalition is that there's no bullshit talk. We sit in the room and we talk about what really matters, what really are the red lines, what are the green lines. And if it's a yellow line that I need to work my folks, Marcelo Vieira is excellent on that. Can you imagine the rural society? It's from the 1800, right, that you guys were formed? And 1900, but still very old. It's one of the oldest societies we have from an industry base in Brazil. And Marcelo is able to go back and talk to people that do not want to see change, to change. And he go back and talk to young agribusiness guys that want to engage on this low carbon economy and say, let's go together, let's do a project together. So I see this change happening because I think we're getting out of our zone of comfort, willing to take risks, and willing to have real conversations together, directed to action, because only good conversation because we like each other, it's not good enough. We're beyond the good dialogue. We now have to get real action done. And I think that's probably why we're feeling that the coalition is becoming more and more effective. It took us 4 weeks to get the deforestation paper from the coalition together. 4 weeks, and most of that because André, who is the lead author of the paper, did not work really hard to get it done in 2 weeks. Otherwise, we would have done it in 2 weeks. Now, the licensing discussion, environmental licensing discussion, took us 4 months. And we had very, very profound debates. And if you see that paper with the principles that we agreed, when I look back at that paper, I would say, if we had that paper when we're discussing the forest code, we would have a better forest code than we have today. Because the quality of that engagement was so good. So I want to stress that I think that there has been a huge leap, but I think that it is very much based on transparency. And I think we need to keep nailing that issue back because it's extremely helpful.
I've known Valeria for a long time, and I certainly agree there's no bullshit. there are many aspects of the story, and I agree the quality of the conversation is very, very important. The problem with telling stories like that is, I was telling Tiogo from EPOM when we were going on a field trip last week, that I had, including it for the first time, that I had went back all these years to this. And when he was introducing me to the group, he said, we're very lucky to have Mark Irby here. He's worked with all the dinosaurs. And I went, oh, that would make me a dinosaur. But I agree the quality of the conversation. And recently I was in a meeting with TFT, and they were talking about a model that they applied to this work. And I mentioned here, because I think oversimplifying, it works, and they refer to it as their VTTV model. And it says, if you get the values right, and you can build the trust, and you can be transparent, then you can figure out the systems to verify, monitor, hold yourselves accountable, work together. Now, they apply that in the work they do, but I thought about that, and I said, you know, in this work, exactly as you described, if we can get the values right, find out we've shown shared values, then we can work on building the trust, building the tent and having that conversation, being more transparent so we can say to you, you know, we need your help. We can't figure this out. This is complicated. And then you can get on building a system that's pragmatic and workable. And I think that's what we have to do when we come into this. So summary, I think, I was thinking of some notes. One, for TFA, here in Latin America, we've been talking and talking and talking. TFA needs to get its agenda right, and it needs to get its agenda out. People need to understand that agenda, and we need to affirm that we have common values. And those values are the forest, but they're also social. They're also economic. We have to figure out how to balance forests and people. The other one is we have to be pragmatic. You know, cargo, you know, you'll get in a room with this and we'll say, it just isn't workable. It isn't pragmatic. It isn't workable. We talked about a Cerrado moratorium this weekend, and I was talking to one of the people on our trip, and I said, it's just not workable. It won't work with the producer sector. And we went to a meeting with Albersocia. We had a very good conversation with a farmer who had totally the right guidance about sustainable intensification and sustainability on the farm, and that, you know, yields are so great that they really probably don't need to expand much more land. And then we said, what do you think of moratorium? And he said, absolutely not. Because he said, it restricts my rights. So you have to enter into that conversation with a very keen mind, right? We need to be focused. I mean, this is where the CFA conversation, there are too many redundant programs out there, a lot of overlap. We have to get focused. We are 33 months away. We have to be very focused on our agenda. And I think what the minister from said earlier was about, we have to really build a strategic agenda that we really are clear on what we're trying to achieve. And we have to do that together. We have to be comfortable with perfect is the enemy of good. We talk and talk and talk and think it's going to be perfect, but if we're going to make progress, you know, perfect is the enemy of good. We have to figure out what's going to work. And then the last thing I think we need to think about, this is like climbing a mountain, right? And when you climb a mountain, a very big mountain, you have lots of base camps. And before you move on to the next high level, which requires more technology, requires more oxygen, requires more collaboration with your teammates, you may go up a ways, acclimate yourself, come back down before you go back up. And we need to apply that thinking in terms of working together, collaborating together, testing what works, maybe come back down, fix it, go back up before we make that final push to the mountaintop. Thank you.
Thank you very much. This was a fantastic discussion. If I may, I'll just try to summarize some of the things that I've heard that are really relevant for the discussions going forward within TFA. And I've heard some interesting things. So the power and the importance of communicating the advances of how far that we've got. Not only just to advertise it, but also to share those lessons, because there are lots of others along the way in that journey. So it's important to share those advances. We heard about the importance of strategic thinking and how we create capacity to look into the future strategically. And having the TFA is one of these thinking spaces where you can think together, but you also can bring your thinking to a broader audience. We've also heard about the importance of collaboration, not to stay just about, you know, keep talking to each other. That's also important, but we need to be results-oriented, thinking about solving problems. So get your agenda right, go out there, get the values right, communicate those values, not just in terms of the actions, but also what you're trying to achieve, right? We also heard about norming, how important it is for the TFA to help us align. There's so much going on with this that the TFA can be this umbrella where we can bring the different initiatives together so that we align around the right values and understand the different solutions out there and share this knowledge. And very importantly as well, the connections between the global and the regional. It's very rare that we actually have a chance to put together all the different regions working on this. You probably know a small group of people in this room, but you won't know everyone, and that's valuable, because it's rare that we bring everyone together, and TFA has this potential of keeping the regional initiatives with the global discussions in sight, and also helping the global discussions to be aware and building on what's the solutions that are arising from tropical countries. And then finally, We also heard a few ideas about, you know, very specific ones about de-risking investment, about stopping illegality. And these are all very interesting agendas that TFA members are already working on and can improve and increase in terms of collaboration. So I would like to thank our panelists. Thank you very much. And I would like to ask you to keep these things in mind as we go forward into the breakout sessions for the knowledge exchange. And with that, I will just ask Petra to come and give us some instructions going forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you also to the panelists. My name is Petra Tanos. I'm here on behalf of the TFA Secretariat. And I just want to take a moment to walk you through the program for the next few hours, where you have an opportunity to learn through a series of knowledge exchange sessions, as well as an opportunity to experience some of the latest tech innovations that are helping to tackle deforestation. So what we're going to do now is move into a coffee break. And at the same time, in the foyer, you'll have a chance to learn about Sustain-a-Drone. Following that, we'll move into our first series of knowledge exchange sessions with NICFI, UNDP, and Rainforest Alliance together with Flora. Then we'll have lunch from 1 to 2, and during that you'll have a chance to learn about TRACE as well as the Global Forest Watch. And then finally, the afternoon knowledge exchange sessions with WWF, IDH, and TNC. And then I ask you to be back here at 3:30 sharp for some remarks by Governor Takas and Minister Helgeson. So thank you very much, and enjoy the next few hours.
After which we will have the panel interstitial leadership.
We're very fortunate to have two very important leaders in the deforestation tree development movement to speak to us this afternoon. We heard from Minister Sarney this morning, heard from Minister Djombo, so we heard from leaders this morning and again this afternoon, other very important leaders. Our first speaker is Governor Pedro Takes, the governor of Mato Grosso. Governor Takes is also the governor of the first subnational jurisdiction to join TFA 2020. So I just want to. Remarks, after which will be followed by Mr. Lopes. Mr. Lopes, the floor is yours.
Boa tarde a todos. Eu poderia falar em russo, alemão ou árabe, mas eu vou preferir o português. Vou falar em português. É uma honra participar desse evento. Vou dividir a minha fala, que são 10 minutos, em três pontos para que nós possamos construir. O primeiro deles, quem sou? O segundo, de onde vim? E o terceiro, o que quero? Primeiro ponto, quem sou? Eu sou o que eu fui. Durante 15 anos eu fui procurador da República no estado de Mato Grosso, membro do Ministério Federal, em que tive algumas ações importantes na questão ambiental. Depois disso, eu fui senador da República e participei dos debates também sobre o Código Florestal. E depois eu fui eleito governador do estado de Mato Grosso, esse estado que é conhecido internacionalmente pelo que produz. Este sou eu sou o que eu fui. Não há determinismo histórico que possa mudar esta realidade. De onde eu vim? Eu vim do estado de Mato Grosso. É um estado com dimensões continentais, tem 904 mil quilômetros quadrados. O nosso estado, nós preservamos 60% dele. Mais ou menos o tamanho da Espanha, ou o tamanho da França, ou o tamanho da Califórnia. 540 mil quilômetros quadrados. Está fazendo certo a versão? Tudo bem? Não? Quero que desconte o meu tempo, por favor. Não? Deve ser algum espantador que está nos boicotando. Ok? Ok. Em homenagem àqueles que vieram de longe, eu vou voltar um pouquinho, tá bom? Quem sou? Eu sou o governador do estado de Mato Grosso, eu sou o que eu fui. Antes eu fui senador da República por 4 anos, participei dos debates nacionais sobre o Código Florestal. Antes disso, eu fui procurador da República por 15 anos, fui representante do Ministério Público Federal em ajuizamento de ações pelo Brasil todo. E fui eleito governador do estado de Mato Grosso. Eu sou o que eu fui. De onde eu vim? Eu vim e sou de um estado que tem dimensões continentais, 904 mil quilômetros quadrados, nós preservamos 60% do nosso território. Esse 60% do nosso território, que é intocável, ele significa 540 mil quilômetros quadrados. É o tamanho da Espanha, ou o tamanho da França, ou exatamente o tamanho da Califórnia. Nesses 40% que estão antropizados, os 60% são unidades de conservação, reserva indígena, área de preservação permanente, reservas legais, 60%. Nos 40% que nós antropizamos, já usado pelo homem, contando aí também as áreas urbanas, as conurbações que temos no nosso estado, nós produzimos muito. Mato Grosso produz 88% do diamante do Brasil, 88%. Nós produzimos 70% do milho de pipoca do Brasil. Eu sou mais Tarantino que Fellini, eu quero dizer isso hoje, porque eu gosto de sangue, né? Não sou tão romântico. Produzimos 67% do algodão do Brasil. Produzimos 65% do girassol do Brasil. 39% da soja do Brasil. Né? Desculpe, 39% do milho. 32% da soja do Brasil. 14% do pescado de água doce do Brasil. E nós temos 30 milhões de cabeças de gado bovino. É o maior rebanho do Brasil. Cada habitante do estado de Mato Grosso tem 10 cabeças de gado. Somos 3 milhões de habitantes. Eu não tenho nenhuma cabeça de gado. Né? Alguém deve estar com as minhas. Eu não tenho nenhuma. E eu quero dizer aos senhores que eu comi churrasco agora no almoço, porque é, a carne de Mato Grosso é de precedente, procedência. Nós temos o IMAC, eu vou falar um pouco sobre ele, na estratégia do PC. Muito bem. Dificilmente Mato Grosso terá uma fábrica de iPhone nos próximos 50 anos. Talvez 60, dificilmente. Como ao assumir o governo do estado, em janeiro de 2015, nós começamos a formular, a estruturar uma estratégia que denominamos de PCI, Produzir, Conservar e Incluir. Esta estratégia, senhor ministro da Noruega, seja bem-vindo ao Brasil, espero que o senhor saia daqui com a certeza, não com a impressão de que nós estamos fazendo muito, apesar dos desafios que nós temos ainda a serem superados. Quando iniciamos essa estratégia PCI, nós chegamos à seguinte conclusão: o Estado sozinho não daria conta de superar os desafios. Por isso, chamamos as organizações não governamentais, o que se denomina no Brasil de sociedade civil, chamamos as federações, as associações, chamamos a iniciativa privada, os empresários, para discutirmos juntos esta estratégia. Esta estratégia, o PCI, Produzir, Conservar e Incluir, ela foi apresentada na COP21 em Paris, em 2015, através do Estado, da iniciativa privada, das associações, federações e também do terceiro setor. O que desejamos com esta estratégia denominada PCI? Nós a denominamos, queremos produzir mais, conservar mais e incluir mais as pessoas que estão à margem do sistema econômico no nosso estado. Exemplo fico. Nesses 40% do nosso território que está antropizado, já usado pelo homem, nós temos 16 milhões de hectares de pastagens de baixa produtividade. 16 milhões de hectares desse tipo de pastagem. Muito bem. Dentre esses 16 milhões, no PCI, na estratégia, nós temos 6 milhões de hectares para serem convertidos em floresta plantada, em agricultura, e na produção agrícola e também na recomposição de APP e reserva legal. Dos 16 milhões, 6 milhões, nós precisamos de ajuda, daí eventos como este são significativos para que nós possamos concretizar esta nossa estratégia. De que maneira é isso? O Brasil hoje produz 217 milhões de toneladas de grãos. 217 milhões, a última safra, que está sendo colhida agora. O estado de Mato Grosso produz, vai produzir 57 milhões de toneladas de grão. Se nós, dentro das 16 milhões de hectares que nós produzimos, sem desmatar uma árvore, nós conseguiríamos produzir em 8 anos metade, 50% de toda a produção de proteína animal e proteína vegetal que o Brasil possui. A produção deve ser aumentada nos 40%. Agora, a que custo? A que preço? O preço que nós firmamos na COP21, enquanto todas as unidades subnacionais do Brasil firmaram metas até 2030, Mato Grosso e o Acre, nesses dois estados subnacionais, nós firmamos esta meta até 2020, acabar com o desmatamento ilegal no nosso estado até 2020. Isso é possível? Isso é possível diante do que nós já fizemos. Exemplo disso, de 2004 até 2016, Mato Grosso reduziu o seu desflorestamento, o seu desmatamento em 87%. Repito, em 87% de 2004 até 2016. Em de agosto de 2014 a julho de 2016, houve um incremento do desmatamento, um aumento do desmatamento, temos que reconhecer isso. No entanto, ainda bem, de agosto de 2015 até 2016, nós já reduzimos a isso em 19%, o que mostra a nossa vontade política, minha como governador, da Secretaria de Meio Ambiente do nosso Estado, que é capitaneada, chefiada pelo vice-governador do nosso Estado, né, de cumprir estas metas até 2015. Produzir, conservar e incluir. De que maneira incluir? De que maneira será feita esta inclusão? Em Mato Grosso, nós temos 720 assentamentos. 720 assentamentos. Com 105 mil famílias de pequenos trabalhadores. 105 mil famílias de assentados que precisam de ajuda. Nestes assentamentos, nós estamos trabalhando com regularização fundiária, dado o título, o documento, aquele que detém aquela terra. Estamos trabalhando com apoio, pesquisa e extensão. Estamos trabalhando com microcrédito para mulheres e um sistema de comercialização do que se produz. Mato Grosso produz muito, como eu fiz referência aqui. Em 5 anos, o Brasil teve um superávit na sua balança comercial, o Brasil todo, no complexo do agronegócio, de 67 bilhões de dólares. 67 bilhões de dólares em 5 anos, o superávit da balança comercial do Brasil. Desses 67 bilhões de dólares, Mato Grosso foi responsável por 62 bilhões de dólares. Ano passado, nós tivemos um superávit na nossa balança comercial de 12 bilhões de dólares em relação ao complexo do agronegócio. Agora, apesar de tudo isso, nós importamos todos os anos 1 bilhão de reais em hortifruti granjeiros. Produzimos muito, mas não temos a valorização da agricultura familiar, o que nós estamos fazendo nesta estratégia de inclusão destes 5 mil, dessas 105 mil famílias, né, que vivem da agricultura familiar. É possível fazer isso sozinho? Não é possível fazer isso sozinho. Nós temos 5 secretarias que estão juntas na concretização deste projeto. Além das secretarias, eu, como governador, participo ativamente deste programa. Nós temos uma direção executiva da estratégia, o Fernando está aqui, que é o secretário executivo da estratégia. Fernando, pode levantar aí, Fernando, faz favor. Temos o secretário executivo da Secretaria do Meio Ambiente do nosso Estado, o André Babi, por favor, André. Que continuarão aqui para que nós possamos debater esses temas. Eu vim aqui para agradecer. Mato Grosso é o primeiro estado subnacional a participar desta aliança. Para nós é um motivo de honra, de orgulho, agora é também um motivo de maior responsabilidade, tendo a importância desta aliança para o futuro, o progresso da humanidade, porque a preservação do que nós temos é importante para a sobrevida das gerações que ainda virão. Eu gostaria de dizer aos senhores mais um dado. Em 10 anos, Mato Grosso reduziu a sua emissão, como nós aqui fizemos referência, em 87% de desmatamento. Isso significou 1,9 gigatoneladas de redução de emissão. 1,9 gigatoneladas. Os Estados Unidos inteiro reduziram em 6 gigatoneladas. Sabemos que a origem é diferente, mas isso tem um significado. Para mim, é um motivo de orgulho, como governador, fazer parte desta aliança. Não só o governo do Estado, mas as instituições que compõem o PCI, são as associações, federações de produtores e a iniciativa privada, junto com a sociedade civil organizada, aqui estamos construindo esta estratégia. Agora, precisamos de ajuda, precisamos de recursos, precisamos de menos discursos e mais recursos para que possamos atingir os nossos objetivos. Aqui no Brasil, o político, muitos falam muito. Eu prefiro falar pouco. O político tem que falar pouco. Falar em pé para ser visto, falar alto para ser ouvido e falar pouco para ser aplaudido. E trabalhar muito. Muito obrigado.
Thank you very much, Governor. Very much appreciated. I wish in my county two politicians would speak standing up and speak less at the moment. And talking about somebody who's speaking standing up and doing a lot, so we are fortunate to have Mr. Vieira, the Minister of Environment of Norway, who's been a great champion of TFA 2020 since he took his role in the Norwegian government about over a year ago, if I remember correctly. And I remember meeting you for the first time in Davos 2 years ago, and you've been at every TFA event, a high-level TFA event since. So it's great to have you here again for the first time in the General Assembly. Please.
Thank you very much. You're taking a risk, of course. Yes, you're asking politicians to talk less, but you're giving me the final word of the day. But I do pledge to do more. Governor Tuck's Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to be here today among so many dedicated partners and allies from forest countries, from the private sector and civil society. And it's a great pleasure to meet in Brazil. It's appropriate that we all meet here in Brazil. Brazil has in many ways led the charge against tropical deforestation. Thanks to impressive leaders like Governor Tarkis, Brazil's reductions in deforestation over the last decade is, simply put, one of the most important contributions to the global battle against climate change. And Norway is proud to have been Brazil's partner in this effort since 2008. Forests can deliver up to a third of what we need in order to achieve the goals of the Paris Agreement. Without protecting and restoring tropical forests at massive scale, we will not be able to meet the Paris targets. Forests are also indispensable to meet the Sustainable Development Goal number 5, life on land. In fact, protecting and restoring global forests are essential to meeting all the Sustainable Development. And the inconvenient truth is that current land use practices undermine the very ecological foundations of our existence. Unless changed fast, the consequences will be grave. On the bright side, the upside of successful land use transformation is massive. People living in rural areas can achieve better and stronger development with more energy. The conditions for growing food and feeding the population will be enhanced. Our environment will be more sustainable. We can have living forests and rich biodiversity. We can reduce emissions. In short, we can protect, produce, and include all at the same time. The starting point for Norway's engagement in the Tropical Forest Alliance is two fundamental facts. First, large parts of tropical agriculture today operate at extremely low productivity. Fixing that will give enormous benefits, not least for smallholders. Second, there is enough non-forested land to meet a growing global demand for food, feed, fuel, and fiber without a need for clearing forest. These facts yield tremendous opportunity for good. Progress will not come by any single action. A large and diverse number of stakeholders must be moving together towards the same goal. One hammer does not build a house. No single tool works in isolation. And that is why the Tropical Forest Alliance can really make a difference by bringing us together for joint, concerted action. For the last 9 years, Norway has developed close partnerships with forest countries through our International Climate Forest Initiative. We're impressed by what our Latin American partners have achieved and what they're aiming to do. Brazil has shown that economic growth and increased agricultural productivity can go hand in hand with reducing deforestation. Brazil has also set up a good platform for international support. The Amazon Fund remains an excellent model for international partnerships to protect and restore tropical forests. The current situation in Brazil, however, does show that progress can't be taken for granted. Continued action is necessary. I was delighted this morning to hear Minister Sarney's strong intervention on how he intends to ensure continued progress in Brazil on our shared agenda. Success in Brazil has been and will remain teamwork. Last year, the Brazilian private sector took the lead in extending the soy moratorium, which for over 10 years has been a cornerstone in the Brazilian transformation. Recently, the Brazilian Coalition on Climate, Forest and Agriculture came with recommendations that safeguards both the stimulation of economic activities and the protection of environmental and social assets. This includes more transparent environmental licensing and maintaining the size of already established protected areas. This coalition consists of more than 150 representatives from private sector, civil society, and academia. As we heard from Governor Takis, the state of Mato Grosso has put in place an innovative production, conservation, and inclusion strategy. It will help the state deliver on its ambitious commitments launched in Paris in 2015. Governor Takis' vision of social and economic development through sustainable land use with zero net deforestation growth is impressive. Combined with other national and jurisdictional efforts, this bears promise of continued reductions in deforestation in Brazil. In neighboring Colombia, the Peace Accord brings enormous opportunities for people and for sustainable management of natural resources. We had a great privilege in Norway to host President Santos for his Nobel Peace Prize award in December. And he moved many of us by his Nobel lecture, including his very strong emphasis on the fact that there will be no sustainable peace without protecting Colombia's nature, forests, and biodiversity. Joining the Tropical Forest Alliance is a natural part of that effort. Had rainforests been a human invention, a result of decades of research and investments, cutting them down would have been unimaginable, given the services that they provide. Actually, speaking of Nobel Prizes, I think the one who invented the rainforest would have received multiple Nobel Prizes. And the fact that they are still being cleared globally at a frightening pace is a market and governance failure of massive proportions. But luckily, it's a failure that is increasingly being addressed by more people in more places and in more ways. I'm very encouraged by the fact that seven African countries at the Climate Summit in Marrakech signed a declaration to safeguard forests and make palm oil production sustainable. They are now developing concrete plans, action plans, to integrate this commitment into national development plans. Liberia is one of the frontrunners in this process. Norway is proud to support the Marrakech Declaration through our forest partnerships. I encourage more countries in Central Africa to join this initiative and partner countries, the private sector and civil society to give it life. And if we move further east along the green belt of the equator to Indonesia, we find more promising developments. I'm hugely inspired by President Jokowi's regulation against destructive activities in peat. His announcement of a forthcoming moratorium on further palm oil plantations is also encouraging. Jokowi administration is clear that this is not about limiting the growth of the palm oil industry. What they are saying is that this growth can happen through productivity growth on existing plantations, and not least for smallholders, and better utilization of degraded and fallow lands. These new regulations can be a critical contribution to reach the goals of the Paris Agreement. Political will in tropical forest countries is essential, and as former Vice President and Nobel laureate Al Gore has said, political will is a renewable resource. Even so, tropical forest countries can't succeed without companies playing on the same team, providing jobs and sustaining green economic growth. Only since last year, 108 companies have announced 212 commitments for deforestation-free supply chains. In total, more than 400 companies, many of the members of the Tropical Forest Alliance, have signed up to eliminate the deforestation footprint of soy, beef, palm oil, and paper. We're now eager to see the result of these pledges on the ground. in this, making that happen, civil society organizations have an important role to play. They monitor implementation and make sure that supply chains are transparent. Indigenous peoples have for centuries played a critical role as stewards of the forest. The sustainable management of indigenous peoples' territories here in Brazil is a case in point. The ability of indigenous peoples to safeguard the forest is a key contribution to the global common good. Friends and colleagues, in this hall, in this assembly, there is massive alignment around the protection, production, inclusion approach to land use in the tropics. But our shared interest in preserving forests will not by itself lead to concerted action. Very simplified, we need three things to succeed. One, we need policy reform agendas in tropical forest countries. That means regulations that make high productivity agriculture, rural livelihoods, and large-scale forest protection and restoration possible. Two, we need investors. We need public finance from developed countries, and private finance from a variety of sources. There is an opportunity to invest in land use transformation, both for commercial reasons and for the public good. I'm very much encouraged that a leading international bank just applied to join the TFA. And three, we need private and public sector innovation facilitated by the two elements I just mentioned. We need innovation in land use to match the innovation in renewable energy. We know it's possible. When given incentives, human creativity will find a way. We here need to be living proof of the two key words of leadership and partnership. Only determined visionary leadership will get us past the depressive slowness of business as usual. And only unprecedented partnerships between public sector, private sector, civil society, and local communities can deliver what we need to see. This is why Norway, in collaboration with tropical forest countries and partners like IDH, the Sustainable Trade Initiative, UN Environment, the Global Environment Facility, and Unilever, are launching a risk-sharing facility. It's going to work with companies that are willing to spare their investments in agricultural production without deforestation. This new fund will selectively support investments in deforestation-free commodity production. It will address the barriers that first movers often meet in switching to more sustainable land use. By providing strategic public funding to take first risk, we can leverage much larger private investments to support deforestation-free business practices and government reform agendas. Committed tropical forest countries are working hard to reform their forest governance and the enabling environment for their agriculture. The fund will only invest in progressive countries, states, and provinces which meet defined criteria. The aim is to develop regulations and incentives that can protect forests and peatlands, stimulate the private sector, and attract investors. Committed commodity producers have signed on to eliminating deforestation in their supply chain. The fund will reduce the risk and cost of reorienting their business from an area-intensive expansion towards increased productivity on existing lands. Importantly, consumer goods companies need to follow suit. They must shift their sourcing practices to states and provinces with commitments and demonstrated progress towards deforestation-free production. I believe this combination that we're all living here, or a multi-stakeholder approach, a regulatory environment, and targeted financial support will hopefully bring us a big step forward. I don't only hope that, I'm confident it will, when all of us here go home from here to show the leadership and the partnership that we need to reach our common goals. Thank you very much.
And thank you all for participating in the in this first part, but we're not done. This is not the last part of the day. We now have a coffee break, and we will get back here on the half hour. There will be a demonstration outside in the foyer of some new technologies. I forget exactly which one, because we have several innovations demonstrated. But it's going to be extremely interesting. If it's not a drone or if it's not something like that, that's not my fault. And then we'll get back here for a very interesting panel. So please be back here at 4:30 and have a good coffee break. Thank you very much. Thank you.